She's got the news. She talks with newsmakers. She encourages us to laugh, and she cries with us. Speaking truth to power and questioning authority daily, it's the Nicole Sandler Show.
Oh my goodness, what a day. Welcome to a Tuesday, everyone. I am Nicole Sandler, coming to you live at NicoleSandler.com on the Progressive Voices Network, streaming video, well, on Facebook Live and on Twitch. I believe we're on Twitch. Are we there on Twitch? Yes, we are. For some reason, Periscope video is not working today, and I don't know why. I played with it, but I don't know. I'll have to attempt it again tomorrow. By the way, tomorrow is October 14th, the day that my YouTube suspension is allegedly lifted. We'll see. But, you know, I've been wondering about something. This is so not, it has nothing to do with anything. But sometimes you just need to, you know, get away from Supreme Court confirmation hearings. There's a thing on YouTube that where they have these videos of people, young people, they're usually like college age kids, who are purporting to listen to classic songs for the first time, and they post these reaction videos. So basically, you know, this morning I watched one with these two kids who look like they're in college, who were listening to Bruce Springsteen's Thunder Road for the first time. First of all, the album Born to Run has been out for 45 years. If you have not yet ever heard Thunder Road, you lead a very sheltered life. And so, you know, they listen to the whole song, and you see them, you know, bopping along, and occasionally a lyric will, you know, cause a reaction. And then they get to the end of the song, and they go, okay, it was all right. It was all right. It was all right. And they rack up thousands of views and money because they get paid. I play 20 seconds of a Don Henley song and I'm suspended from streaming for 3 months. How does that work? If anybody knows anyone at YouTube, I'd really love to speak to a human being to figure that out. Anyway, that's my question for the day. Yes, I'm stalling because I really don't want to talk about what I've been watching, which is day two of the confirmation hearing in the Senate Judiciary Committee of Amy Coney Barrett, who has been a judge, the best I can tell, for a whopping 3 years. She was a professor. She was a law professor, I guess, before she was nominated by Trump for a seat on an appellate court. She's never been a lawyer. She's never tried a case in a courtroom. I was surprised to learn that today, as one of the senators was questioning her and said, I know you've not tried a case, but, and she's being considered for the Supreme Court. Why? Because she's ultra right wing, and that's all these people care about. And by these people, I'm talking about the Republicans. I'm talking about Mitch McConnell and his ilk. And these morons who sit on this committee who are doing Trump's bidding, who are cheating the American people out of a Supreme Court justice for the second time, mind you. And it just blows my mind. She is wholly unqualified. I'm sorry. If you've never tried a case and you've been a judge for a whopping 3 years, you are not qualified to sit on the Supreme Court. Period. End of statement. Sue me. If she's the judge, you'll win. I'm just so disgusted by all this. I really am. you know, we are in right now the fight of our lives. And I know you've heard this before, but so I want to start today, kind of, with a song, because I haven't played one in a while. I mean, like a funny to start the show with. And this one, it's not necessarily a funny, but it is a cover of a song that is, well, it rings, it should be a clarion call for us today. And I say that because, well, it's a Pete Seeger song, and it's been covered by so many people. And I'm going to try, if I can figure out how to get this thing going, to play it for you here by a group of, well, they are I don't know what they call themselves. They are female impersonators who sing. Are they trans? Are they transsexuals? I don't know. Trans women? I don't know. They call themselves Kinsey Six. And, well, I'll just let them take it away, and you judge for yourself. It's called What Side or Which Side Are You On?
Which side are you on? Which side are you on? Which side are you? Which side are you? Which side are you on? Which side are you on? Which side are you on?
When you hear Black Lives Matter, do you get annoyed? Does it push some buttons you'd rather just avoid? Why you feel this way does not need Sigmund Freud. If you do not have to fear, you'll be the next George Floyd.
If you're not black, here's one guideline. Do not sit back on the sidelines.
I won't look away, I won't look away. I won't look away, I won't look away.
We can't look away, we can't look away, we can't look away. We can't look away, we can't look away.
There's always some good reason, that reason isn't pleasing. They like it open season, that's why protest is treason. But you learn if you're white, don't fight, just keep it light. Being impolite gives fright, keep your lips tight and you're alright.
We win comfort with our silence, but our silence sanctions violence.
Time to take a stand, time to take a stand. Time to take a stand, time to take a stand. Time to take a, time to take a, time to take a stand. Time to take a stand, time to take a stand.
They want us cynical, they want our cowardice. They know us shutting up, keep others powerless. And the same power that will kneel on one man's throat is the power that's working every hour to suffocate the vote.
Make a promise, make it formal. There's no going back to normal.
If your party's base's latest taste is to embrace a racist, is a safe space for the case that women and blacks should know their places.
Praise for those who praise a man who preys on those with darker faces. Build a wall and Jews will not replace us are their favorite phrases.
Hates Asians on workplaces, slams of trans and gays.
Praise Jesus!
Then debases using photo op showcases to win races.
We will not let you erase us. Haters get no safe oasis.
Which side are you on? 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 Which side are you? Which side are you? Which side are you on? Which side are you on? Which side are you on?
Spread the word, shit's been stirred. We will be heard on November 3rd. Spread the word, no more dreams deferred. We will be heard on November 3rd.
Spread the word, shit's been stirred. We will be heard on November 3rd. Spread the word, no more dreams deferred. We will be heard on November 3rd.
If your party's base is latest, taste is to embrace the racist. Is a safe space for the case that women and black should know their places. Praise for those who praise a man who prays on those with darker faces. Build a wall and Jews will not replace us are their favorite phrases. Is a Asians on their places, slams the trans and gays. Praise Jesus, then their faces using photo op showcases.
We spread the word, no more dreams deferred. We will be heard on November 3rd.
Have you heard? We've been spurred. We're in this fight till November 3rd. Have you heard? We've been spurred. We're fighting long past November 3rd.
We're fighting long past November 3rd. Kinsey Six is where they go. And yes, I was wrong. Actually, Which Side Are You On? There was a Pete Singer Seeger song, Which Side Are You On? This is original music and lyrics by Benjamin Schatz. Go figure. Vocal arrangement by Jeff Manabot. And those are Kinsey Six with a very timely topical song. I'm stalling because I don't want to get to this hearing, but I guess we need to. Let me start with a little bit of what went on yesterday. Although we talked about it yesterday, we were on the air after the hearing yesterday, so we don't actually have to repeat any of that. You know what we should do is get GottaLaff on the line and go through what happened today and beyond. Before we do that, though, let me take a quick break so our friends at the Progressive Voices Network can get a couple of ads in. So take it away, guys. While they do that, you know what? There's so much stuff I want to play for you, but I don't want to do it while Progressive Voices is on a break because I don't want them to miss any of it. So I'll tell you what. I mean, I'm breaking all the formats of, you know, radio. I shouldn't play another song, but I've had so many requests. I play these song parodies all the time. I've gotten more requests for one of them than any other. And, because you asked, this time it was Henry who actually called last night. I kid you not. The show ended at 6 Eastern, right? My phone rings literally like the minute I turned off the microphone. The phone rings, and so I pick it up off the air, and it's Henry who introduces himself and thanks and says, I just got to hear that song again. You know what song I'm talking about, don't you? I think you do. And actually, I tweeted it out this morning again because I get a lot of requests for it, and somebody objected to one little part in this. So I'm going to play it for you and ask if you can figure out which part they objected to. It's a little ditty, and I couldn't even tell you who sings it because I wound up downloading the video and I didn't put the guy's name on it, so I don't even know. I got to find him because he's got a hit on his hands. Seriously. And it's called I Fucking Hate Donald Trump.
Well, I love my mama and my daddy. I love my wife and my son. So guitar, but I fucking hate Donald Trump. I love going out honky tonking. I love getting my buddies drunk. I love standing up for my country, but I fucking hate Donald Trump. In all my years, I never carried hate in my heart. Takes up all the fucks I have to give. I love my mama and my daddy. I love my wife and my son. I love picking on this old guitar, but I fucking hate Donald Trump. Yeah, I love the U.S. Constitution, but I fucking hate Donald Trump.
Nicole Sandler Show.
The Nicole Sandler Show.
On the Progressive Voices Network.
If the news gives you the blues, here's the perfect place to go. It's Tuesdays with GottaLaff on the Nicole Sandler Show.
Ah, our pal GottaLaff joins us every Tuesday to shoot the shit about the news, and I know she's in the same hell I'm in. So let's get her on the line now, see if we can't connect. Let me push some buttons here and there. Hello?
Well, yes, you've reached another week from hell hotline.
Yeah, baby, it's what we live.
And that was before the today's hearings. Oh, boy. You're coming a little quiet. Let me just
It's probably me. Okay. There we go.
Okay. Press one, if you think when Trump said he was cured of COVID, it shows that even the virus is deserting him.
Yeah.
Press two, if you think Trump thought National Coming Out Day meant coming out on a balcony, ripping open his shirt and revealing a Superman logo.
Oh, God, please.
Press three if you think that if the fly that landed on VP Pius McKissass's head laid eggs, he'd have to carry them to full term.
Yeah, I'd love to see that, actually. That would
You're
be
still a little quiet. Okay, so I'm trying I'm to perfect. I'm why is my. Oh, my God. Well, I was just wondering why my phone was suddenly on camera. I haven't touched it. That's weird.
There's all kinds of all kinds of stuff going on. I'm telling you, I've got gremlins here today as well.
Yeah, I know. I'm just seriously. So I'm trying to get her voice down. I'm a Supreme Court judge.
Yeah, you just need some
like
helium. You need some helium to take. And then
know.
We can sound like Judge Amy Coney Barrett. You have
That's
to make
right.
this face in order to get your voice up that high. Have you noticed?
Look at me. I go to church and have seven children that I sound like. What's with her voice, Nicole? It's driving me crazy.
Yeah, I know. It's a helium thing. I think she lives in a different stratosphere, so I guess it's the helium she's breathing up there.
God, it's so annoying. I mean, the first time I heard it, I literally jumped. I went,
yeah, me too. It's like, oh my, that voice. By the way, I am monitoring the feed mostly because I want to hear Senator Kamala Harris when she questions.
I'm glad you're doing that.
So I will try to remember to cut away. If anybody notices that I'm not paying attention and Kamala Harris comes on, right now it's Joni Ernst, who, I guess like me, you know, she hasn't had a haircut through the pandemic. She needs one like I do. Although, yeah, I guess what she's got going on now is better than the helmet hair Devo helmet that she used to have.
That was awful.
I'm being really catty just because I've sat and watched this shit since 9 o'clock this morning, except for their couple of little breaks. And during their breaks, I pulled clips. And I'm just like hesitant to play any of it because it's just so horrendous. I really don't like what I'm hearing today. I do like some of the Democrats who are asking questions. Once again, Sheldon Whitehouse. Oh my goodness. Wow. He's my hero.
Yeah, he did great. He did great. And so did Klobuchar.
Amy Klobuchar did really well as well. In fact, she, you know, she tried to get her to answer the question of whether she would I mean, simple questions that should be no-brainers. Like, will you say voter intimidation is illegal?
Oh, yeah, I've got that in my stash.
Oh, do you? Okay, because I've got the clip.
You want to go to it?
Yeah, when you go through them, you know what? Before you get to these, let's just do a couple of other things. There was a debate last night in Kentucky between Mitch McConnell and Amy McGrath. Now, I didn't watch it. I saw one clip that made its way around the interwebs today, and I need to play it. For anybody who's listening to audio, obviously you'll hear the audio, but I pulled the video because you need to look at Mitch McConnell's face when Amy McGrath is calling him out on serious shit. He laughs. He has this very uncomfortable looking smile, which is the face I'm guessing he makes when he goes in for a check in the doctor when they stick their finger up your butt. That's the look that I think he gets. That's just watch the look on his face as she's speaking, and it's astounding. And the fact that he's laughing through this question, through her questions, is insulting as hell. So this happened. Here we go.
The House passed a bill in May, and the Senate went on vacation. I mean, you just don't do that. You negotiate. Senator, it is a national crisis. Yeah. You knew that the coronavirus wasn't going to end at the end of July. We knew this. I mean, I just think you've got to. And here's the thing. If you want to call yourself a leader.
So, Bill.
If you want to call yourself a leader, you got to get things done. And those of us that served in the Marines, we don't just point fingers at the other side. We get the job done.
Oh my goodness. All he does is laugh. There was nothing. Why am I echoing? Hold on. That's not supposed to echo.
That's sexy though.
There we go. Okay, echo's gone. There was nothing funny about that. It was this really nervous, creepy laugh.
Yeah. Yeah. It was really horrible. Odd, and it lasted way too long.
Yes. And way every time they go to him, he has this smile on his face.
It was it was glued, right? Yeah.
How, you know, you got to wonder how he got.
You do that too well. Oh, God, here we go.
Not again.
By the way, I just want to do.
Yes.
This news, the Supreme Court has allowed the Trump administration to shut down the census count early.
What the fuck?
Sotomayor wrote a dissent, and that's all I know.
Oh, my God. And you know what? That's not all. Hold on. Let me pull out my notes from the news today, because that's not the only one. The Supreme Court this morning also declined to take up a case brought by 29 Senate Democrats who alleged that Donald Trump violated the Constitution's Emoluments Clause, which prohibits self-dealing by federal office holders. The lawmakers, 29 Senate Democrats, had asked the Supreme Court to review a February ruling by a 3-judge panel of the D.C. Circuit Court of Appeals that the senators lacked the legal right to sue the president. if you know, if anybody has standing, it's members of the U.S. Senate whose job it is to perform oversight. And now the Supreme Court is saying they're not going to take this up. So that lets the lower court standing ruling mm-hmm. stand.
That's what we're faced with now. It was Trump judges.
Unbelievable.
Wasn't it? Was that the one that was Trump judges, or was that a different one?
You know, I don't know. It was a 3-judge panel from the D.C. Circuit instead of the full, you know, panel, an en banc hearing, which is what's his name, got done in the Michael Flynn case, thankfully, because that one's still going. But this 3-judge panel of the larger bench, I'm sorry, that shit needs to stop.
Yeah, that was the three Trump judges. And there were about 2 or 3 other rulings that went against Democrats on voting. They were all voter suppression rulings. One of them was in Texas where they are allowing only 1 drop box for that huge, gigantic county.
1 drop box per county.
Per county.
Per county. Yeah. But then in California, this is lovely. The Republican, the California Republican Party put up these fake drop boxes, and people called them out, and they were told to take them down, and now they're refusing.
They refused the cease and desist. They said that it was that ballot harvesting is okay.
Oh,
here it is, right here on Salon. California GOP refuses to comply with Attorney General's order to remove illegal ballot drop boxes. The GOP is willing to lie, cheat, and threaten our democracy, all for the sake of gaining power, Gavin Newsom says.
Oh my God. This is, you know what they are doing now, what Trump does, which is denying reality. Right. It's the, you know, the sky is blue. Oh no, it isn't. It's green. And I've got all these hundreds of thousands of people who will back me up on that. It's green.
Yeah, right.
Oh God.
That's right. And then there was another ruling. There were 2 rulings. I think it was about the time, the amount of time you had to vote, or the time they had to count. Votes.
Actually, I thought our side won the counting thing. I forget what state it was, but they're going to get to count for like an extra week.
Well, there was one that said November 13th is no longer a thing.
Oh, really?
Let me see. It should be in my. Yeah. Oh, come on. Come on.
Come on.
Come on. So many tweets have come up since then that I'm having trouble finding. Oh, here, that's the Supreme Court. I can't find it right now. Here it is. Here it is. Indiana's Election Day deadline for accepting absentee ballots is back on. The Seventh Circuit reversed a district judge who had ordered the state to count mail-in ballots through November 13th.
Wow. So
a bunch of them came in like that.
I don't understand.
Because the courts are packed now, and that's what they're objecting. If we want to pack the courts, it's wrong. If they do it,
course.
It's fine.
Of course.
Anyway, let's go for it, because I've got so many tweets.
Okay, let loose the birdies!
The birdies!
The birdies! Oh, yeah, and Joni Ernst. Just don't question me.
Tweet.
Okay. Oh, tweet. Shit. And I just realized I'm so bad. I thought I brought back Progressive Voices from the spot. They're back now. Sorry about that, Progressive Voices.
Hi, Progressive Voices. Sorry.
Anybody who's still there? Yeah.
Yikes.
I'm hearing the delay from inside where David's listening. I just heard tweet, tweet, tweet. And I'm like, where's that coming from? I think I need a vacation. Okay. All right.
Okay. I just got this new tweet in. I was going to talk about how Barrett used the term sexual preference, and she got a lot of flack for that. So Hirono challenged her on this just a few minutes ago, and she said, quote, "I certainly didn't mean and would never mean to use a term that would cause any offense in the LGBTQ community. So if I did, I greatly apologize for that."
Unbelievable. Who said that?
Barrett.
She had, okay.
She said sexual preference. Geraldo called her out on it.
Because it's not a preference. It's an orientation.
But
preference implies choice.
If I did.
Oh, one of those apologies.
Yes, I greatly apologize. I certainly didn't mean and would never mean to use a term that would cause any offense in the LGBTQ community. So if I did, I greatly apologize for that. So if I didn't, I don't apologize. It's so easy. See how easy that was?
Oh, yes.
Here's a funny one, because I won't answer after another. You know, it's one vague non-answer. So Andrew Lawrence, who is director of rapid response for the Media Matters, said, Senator, do you believe it's illegal to break the law? And then Barrett, I'm not going to get into hypotheticals. That was a joke. It wasn't real.
Okay, thank you, because you're scared, because she did that a lot.
Yes,
she wouldn't
exactly.
answer anything. So, you know what, can I play this? We talked about Amy Klobuchar. She wouldn't say if voter intimidation is illegal. I couldn't make this shit up if I tried.
Do you believe it's illegal to break the law? And then Barrett.
Oh,
I sound just like Amy Klobuchar.
That's so weird. How are you coming back? I see. I bet you're coming through Facebook.
I always come back.
Okay, boy, I got gremlins
I'm never
today.
Leave.
Got gremlins today. Okay, now, Amy Klobuchar.
Last week, a contractor from outside of my state of Minnesota started recruiting poll watchers with special forces experience to protect polling locations in my state. This was clear voter intimidation. Similar efforts are going on around the country, solicited by President Trump's false claims of massive voter fraud, something that, by the way, many Republican leaders, including Michael Steele, the former head of the Republican Party, including Tom Ridge, including Governor Kasich, including sitting Senator Romney, have made very clear is not true. So as a result of his claims, people are trying to get poll watcher, special forces people to go to the polls. Judge Barrett, under federal law, is it illegal to intimidate voters at the polls?
Yes.
Senator Klobuchar, I can't characterize the facts in a hypothetical situation, and I can't apply the law
just
to a hypothetical
said.
Set of
oh
facts.
My God, there's nothing hypothetical here.
I can only decide cases
here.
As they come to me, litigated by parties on a full record after fully engaging
full
precedent, talking to colleagues, writing an opinion,
blah, blah, blah.
So I can't answer questions
like that.
I'll make it easier.
18 U.S.C. 594 outlaws anyone who intimidates, threatens, coerces, or attempts to intimidate, threaten, or coerce any other person for the purpose of interfering with the right of such other person to vote.
Sounds
this
pretty cut and dry
to me.
Been
on the books for decades.
Yeah.
Barrett wouldn't say if people would feel intimidated by armed poll watchers, and wouldn't say if it was illegal to do that.
Unbelievable. Unbelievable.
Either of those things.
And I don't know if they have guns. I don't know what's so dangerous about guns.
Right?
I like guns.
Right.
Guns and God.
Guns and
Yay.
God. And I have 7 children. Did you know?
Oh, yeah, 7 kids.
Yes.
We're going to do a movie.
She also wouldn't say that Roe v. Wade was a super precedent.
Right.
Did you hear this exchange? This
yes.
is a quickie. Just,
yes.
This is mind-blowing.
Alan from Harvard said, Roe is not a super precedent because calls for its overruling have never ceased, but that doesn't mean that Roe should be overruled. It just means that it doesn't fall on the small handful of cases like Marbury versus Madison and Brown versus the board that no one questions anymore.
Is United States for Virginia military, is that super precedent?
Senator Klobuchar, if you continue to ask questions about super precedents that aren't on the list of the super precedents that I discussed in the article that are well acknowledged in the constitutional law literature, every time you ask the question, I will have to say that I can't grade it.
Okay. Stop asking me
well,
questions.
I am then left with looking at the tracks of your record and where it leads the American people.
Oh,
and
my God.
I think it
God.
Leads us to a place that's going to have severe repercussions for
you
them.
Think?
Thank you.
Oh, my God. She was too much.
Don't ask me anything. I can't answer anything. Don't. Why am I here? I want that coffee cup. Give me coffee cup. Mommy.
Yeah. Oh. Yeah.
Cory Booker's on.
Yes, Cory Booker's on.
Okay, so Ari Berman said, what we've learned from Amy Coney Barrett today. One, refuse to say whether Trump can delay the election. He can't. 2, refuse to say whether voter intimidation is legal. Illegal. It
right.
is.
Yes, it is.
3, refuse to say whether she'd recuse from post-election dispute. She should. That's what he said. That's what she won't do. She's a baby and we hate her.
She's
somebody just said, I quoted her. I don't even know if I have my tweet. I think I do have this tweet, but I quoted her and she made a reference to church. It was just a minor reference to church, which I hope I have later.
I want
and
someone.
Some troll just came up to me. It came up to me, just tweeted me and said, oh, so you're anti-religion? I said, that was a quote from her, you ass.
Oh, my God. You know what? I want someone to ask her, though. Yes. From my research, I see that People of Praise believes that the woman is subservient to the man.
Yes.
Do you believe that? Is that part of your belief? If so, how can you be a judge? Do you have to consult with your husband before you write a decision?
She'll say that she can't answer that because she
hasn't. It's a hypothetical.
Yet.
Right. Yeah. Oh, my God.
All right. So Adam Klassfeld said this. Senator Ted Cruz says Democrats will appoint justices who will ban books. The only cases seeking to block publication of books that have hit the U.S. courts in recent memory have come from Trump and his family seeking to block John Bolton and Mary Trump's memoirs.
That's true. And by the way, did you hear that it looks like the DOJ and Bill Barr are Malaria's personal attorneys now, too, because
they are
moving on her behalf to take all of the proceeds from Malaria's former friend's book, whatever her name was.
Yeah, because of the breaking the what's it called, a PDA?
Oh, the NDA.
NDA.
Because Trump makes everyone sign a non-disclosure agreement. I don't think those things hold up in court.
They don't.
Honey, can you just get the DOJ on there for me?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Sure. I'll just get, what's his name? I'll get Billy Barr. He's my personal Roy Cohn.
I may let you into the bedroom tonight, then.
Brian Schatz said, Sheldon Whitehouse is using his 30 minutes to speak the truth about the dark money operation behind these SCOTUS efforts, and reporters are complaining that his historic remarks are not in the form of a question. Like it's like Jeopardy, right? So Matthew Miller, you know, the justice and security analyst, he says, amen, I usually agree with that criticism, but what is the point of asking questions a nominee won't answer in a hearing at which the chairman has said the outcome is preordained? The hearing isn't on the level, so no need to treat it as such.
Damn Ding. Straight. Damn straight. And in fact, Sheldon Whitehouse yesterday, I thought, was the best. And in fact, it inspired me to run the interview that I recorded a week or so ago with this woman named Jennifer Taub, who wrote a book called Big Dirty Money. And it's great. And it was a great interview. It was just recorded because I had a build up, sort of like a traffic jam of things. So I had that interview ready to go. And Sheldon Whitehouse gave me the perfect lead into it. So I played it back yesterday. I'm glad I did because it was perfect. But today, Sheldon Whitehouse picked up where he left off. Let me play one clip for you. Today is the 13th, right? Whitehouse. Okay, so here's just a little bit of Sheldon Whitehouse today. And you're right, he didn't ask her any questions. He educated her a little bit.
A, to me, pretty big deal. I've never seen this around any court that I've ever been involved with, where there's this much dark money and this much influence being used. Here's how the Washington Post summed it up. This is a conservative activist behind-the-scenes campaign to remake the nation's courts, and it's a $250 million dark money operation.
$250 million
is a lot of money to spend if you're not getting anything for it.
You think?
So that raises the question, what are they getting for it?
Mm.
Well, I showed the slide earlier on the Affordable Care Act.
Oh, he had props. It
and
was
on Obergefell.
Oh, he sure did.
And on Roe versus Wade, that's where they lost.
Mm-hmm.
But with another judge, that could change. That's where the contest is. That's where the Republican Party platform tells us to look at
this
how they
the
want
part.
Judges to rule, to reverse Roe, to reverse the Obamacare cases, and to reverse Obergefell and take away gay marriage. That
you know,
is their
she's
stated
saying-
objective and plan. Why not take them at their word?
She's saying that
but there's another piece
I haven't had any discussions.
And
hold on, I'm trying to pause this.
Not what's ahead of us,
but what's behind us. What she said that she hasn't had any discussions with anybody about any of this, and what Sheldon Whitehouse is pointing out there is you don't have to. Their platform tells you exactly what they want done. It's all there in black and white.
And so did Trump's tweets, and so did Trump's speeches, and so did Trump's interviews. There is no way she doesn't know what they want, and all she has to do is say, well, I never spoke to him about it.
Right. Yeah. But Sheldon Whitehouse just explained why you don't have to speak to them about it. They make it perfectly clear.
Right.
What's behind us is now 80 cases, Mr. Chairman.
80 cases. Listen to this part.
80 cases under Chief Justice Roberts.
Yep.
That have these characteristics. One, they were decided 5-4 by a bare majority. Two, the 5-4 majority was partisan, in the sense that not one Democratic appointee joined the five. I refer to that group as the Roberts Five. It changes a little bit, as with Justice Scalia's death, for instance. But there's been a steady Roberts Five that has delivered now 80 of these decisions. And the last characteristic of them is that there is an identifiable Republican donor interest in those cases.
Wow.
And in every single case, that donor interest won. It was an 80-0, 5-4 partisan route, ransacking.
Yeah, and he goes on from there. But, there is historical data that shows this is a partisan court. You know, some of them talked about how, you know, in the old days, Ruth Bader Ginsburg was confirmed by a vote of 96-2 or something like that. Yeah, those days are over. They do not exist anymore.
Yep, totally agree.
Yep.
Yeah. Oh, boy. No, he really schooled him.
He was great. Let me play you one more quick 40-second clip from Sheldon Whitehouse, then I'm done with White House. But he was so good.
Okay. I'd love to make that argument to the jury. I'd be really hard-pressed to be the lawyer saying, no, 80-0 is just a bunch of flukes. All 5-4, all partisan, all this way. So something is not right around the court.
You think?
And dark money has a lot to do with it. Special interests have a lot to do with it. Donors trust and whoever's hiding behind donors trust has a lot to do with it. And the Bradley Foundation orchestrating its amici over at the court has
amici.
A lot.
It's like amicus files, I guess. Amici, I guess, is the plural of amicus briefs. But you know what? There he is, Sheldon Whitehouse. I guess that was his job, connecting the big dirty money.
Yeah.
To these Supreme Court rulings and the stacking of the court, which is exactly what they did. You know, they're so freaked out. Oh, the Democrats may stack the court. No, that's what the Republicans are doing. Because for the last year, of Obama's term, we know they held open Scalia's seat. They would not let him fill it, but they also held open 200 judicial openings. It's not that Obama was lazy and didn't nominate anyone. No. It's that McConnell wouldn't bring any of them up for a vote, so that when their guy got in, they had all these openings. It wasn't negligence on the part of the Democrats. It was chicanery, to use Biden's word, on behalf of the Republicans.
Did you see her face when he was going through his spiel with all the props, you know, all the...
Yes.
She was absolutely, like, her eyes were wide open. Her brow was furrowed. It looked as if she had never, like, she was, somebody shocked her with a prod.
Yes. Like, oh, she had a stick up her ass.
Yeah, she couldn't believe it, what he was saying, because it's the first time probably anyone ever put that to her face.
Yep.
Anyway, Cori Bush. Okay, so Sahil Kapoor said, Senator, just from yesterday, Senator John Kennedy. You know Senator Kennedy?
Oh, God, yes.
Yeah. He says, it hurts to be called a racist.
Wait, hold on, I've got it.
And I know, for someone unaccustomed to it, that it hurts to be called a racist. I think it's one of the worst things you can call an American.
Okay. Good. Yeah. So Cori Bush said, just wait till you hear what racists call us.
Ooh.
Zing. Zing a zing, zing, zing.
Yeah.
So yesterday, and I had mentioned this to you today when we were just chatting, Chuck Todd said this when he was after they cut to him when there was a break in the hearing.
Yeah.
He said, it has been more about health care than Roe. Okay, Roe is health care.
I got to
Roe is health care. He knows this.
Yeah, you know.
This is not new to him.
NBC.
It's Chuck Todd.
Get rid of Chuck Todd. Seriously, oh you couldn't find
hey,
anyone
you know that
better.
He was on all day today as the anchor?
Yeah. I know, because I turned it off.
Yeah, I did too. I couldn't take it. So what are all these? Oh, I keep getting alerts about the census thing. If you're hearing my alerts,
that's what
go
the
off.
Alerts are. I can't believe, you know, it's just stunning. And so now everything's going to be undercounted and everybody's going to be underrepresented. If you have not yet filled out the census, go online and do it. Just Google.
It takes 5 minutes.
Fill out census. If you have not filled out a survey for your home, do it now. You can do it online. It will take you all of 5 minutes. I did it the first day. The very first day it was available. Yeah. There's no excuse not to. And there was somebody in the chat room back months ago. It's like, I'm not filling that out. Well, then you're a moron. But the government's going to know it. They know where you are anyway. This is the official way they count people so that they can decide, you know, how much representation each district gets. If you're not counted, you're not counted, and you get no representation in terms of a congressman. You get less money for schools and public services. It's idiotic. If you have not filled out the census yet for your household, it's one per household. Do it now.
All caps bolded.
Thank you.
72 font.
Yes.
Nicholas Carlson, who is with Business Insider, he said, anti-abortion groups say they stand behind Trump's use of a drug tested on cells derived from an aborted fetus because the president was not involved with that abortion.
Do they know that for sure?
That's what Schooley said. How do they know for sure? And I mean, that's a pretty low standard. So it depends on whose abortion or whose fetus it was, whose abortion it was. I mean,
they've never made that distinction before.
Never.
If it used the product of aborted tissue, that was enough for them to have a group freak out.
But if it's not Trump's, whoever he boinked, it doesn't matter.
Right. It's not one of his illegitimate children running around.
Illegitimate boinks.
Right.
So this morning I was watching and I was, bleary-eyed at 6:15 in the morning trying to figure out what people were saying in English. I mean, I just like, it's too early. I even with coffee, I couldn't follow. But Dianne Feinstein, my senator, who I wish would just go away. I didn't want to vote for her and I didn't in the primary and then I had to. But anyway, she started out by fawning all over Barrett and her children and telling her what a good mother she was.
And did she have them introduce them again or say what age?
Yeah, they put the camera on them. She said, tell me their names again. Well, they're just adorable. God. You're a good mom. Wow, look at you. You balance everything and oh gosh, you're great.
Well, she was, I guess, trying to win her over because the last time Amy Coney Barrett came before, because she said, ooh, the dogma is thick with you, because she doesn't even know how to question her about her not really a religion, sect, cult that she belongs to.
Ugh. All right. Barrett refused to say that Trump doesn't have the constitutional power to unilaterally delay
an election.
He does not have that power. Let's emphasize this point. That was from Ari Berman,
so
you know.
Yep.
Just make the point that if it comes to court, his court that he wants her on so that she will vote on his side against the Democrats and say that the voting was rigged, she just pretty much gave a pass to that whole thing. She said she refused to say whether he doesn't have power to delay the election, sure, or anything else.
Unbelievable. She also would not say that she would recuse herself from any cases having to do with the election. I mean, seriously? After Donald Trump, they put up a tweet, a Donald Trump tweet, when he said flat out, this is the reason I'm rushing this through, because we need to have 9 justices on the court in case they've got to decide the election. He's putting her on there specifically to do his bidding to make sure to do another Bush v. Gore.
And she's well aware of it because every Democratic senator has said to her, you're there to do his bidding. Yep. Here, let us list the ways. And she was like,
well, I can't really comment because it would be playing pundit, and I'm a judge. Did you know she's only been a judge for like, three years?
That's what I was saying. She was a professor before Trump tapped her to sit on the appeals court.
And 80-plus of her co-workers signed a letter for
saying
her not
don't,
to...
Exactly. Well, yeah. You know, it's like
Notre Dame.
Kaylee McEnany said she's a Rhodes Scholar. And one of the reporters said, are you sure about that? Yes. Well, she went to Rhodes College.
Rhodes College, right?
Oh, my God. No, let me spell it out for you, Kaylee. Or should I just call you Ninny? A Rhodes Scholar is somebody who gets a special
like Rachel Maddow?
Scholarship to go over to Oxford and study there to be a Rhodes Scholar. You go to Oxford in England. It's not Rhodes College, wherever the hell that is. Oh, my God.
Oh, and on the sexual preference thing, Ashton Pittman, who is a journalist, said, Judge Barrett, can you explain why you use the term sexual preference instead of sexual orientation would have been an appropriate follow-up to the question. And it took all this time, and when Hirono finally asked, hours, okay, when was this tweet from? This was from 7:15 this morning.
Oh, my.
And Hirono just finally asked that question and got the semi-apology, the non-apology
yeah.
apology.
Well, if you took it that way, I'm sorry.
Yeah, if that's how it came across.
If you were offended, I apologize for that. Not for what I said, but for the fact that you were offended.
Yeah, exactly. Ugh. Okay, so I did a tweety that said, I love how all these Republicans are saying it's wrong for a judge to say how they would rule, yet Trump's standard for picking a justice was that they would get rid of Roe and right. all the other things. So they keep, and today they're still on that track. They're still saying, you know, you guys, you're all over for her for how she would rule. How dare you?
How dare
how
you?
How dare you, you Democrats, you?
Yeah.
And that's how it's been set up for them.
Yeah.
So I don't know.
I don't know either.
And as Ellie Mistal said, until White House came on, it was getting boring.
Yeah. Well, Sheldon Whitehouse kicked it into gear, I will tell you
right.
that.
Right. Hey,
yeah.
But Ellie said, you know it's bad when you're a Democrat and you're just sitting here wishing the Democrats would be out of time.
Well, you know, and what about Kamala Harris? I guess, is she not going to be able to, she's not going to quit. They're up to Cory Booker now.
They're going to,
I don't know where she
is. They're going to go till 9 o'clock
Eastern.
Oh,
right.
And she's on at the end because she's, you know.
A junior senator. Right. They go in seniority. So, yeah.
She will be on. Yeah.
Yeah.
So Zoe Tillman tweeted, Grassley asks if Barrett had made promises to anyone about how she, this is what we're talking about, how she'd rule in a particular case.
Yeah.
And Barrett said, I want to be very, very clear about this, Senator Grassley.
I want to be very, very clear about this, Senator Grassley. The answer is no.
Asked if she committed to anyone to vote against the ACA, she replies,
absolutely not.
But you don't have...
I love the voice. I thought I could do it, but I'm more scratchy like a man. But you got her down pat without even inhaling helium.
Well, I'm not... telling you anything else. I'm just going to deny everything.
She's like a duck.
Yeah.
Anyway,
okay. Yeah.
We've discussed how she's evaded. So I that was why I put that tweet up. So then Aaron Rupar has a clip of Grassley.
Yes.
And then he does a quote over it. And the clip is Grassley, so we don't have to even worry about what he's saying. But Aaron Rupar's comment was,
wait
quote,
a minute. Okay. Go ahead.
Oh, she has family members with pre-existing conditions is the new I have black friends.
Yeah. I gasped because I just was going over, I looked at Aaron Rupar's feed.
Oh,
and
yeah?
So Cory Booker is asking questions right now, but this is how fast Aaron Rupar is in getting clips up. So he's got a clip up of Cory Booker questioning her, and it says, wow. Under questioning from Booker, Coney Barrett won't even say that she thinks presidents should commit to the peaceful transfer of power.
Holy crap.
You want to hear it? It's like 2 minutes.
Yes.
Here we go.
Do you have it?
Yep. Here we go.
At least at this time. Here's another one.
Okay.
Do you believe that every president should make a commitment unequivocally and resolutely to the peaceful transfer of power?
Well, Senator, that seems to me to be pulling me in a little bit into this question of whether the president has said that he would not peacefully leave office. And so to the extent that this is a political controversy right now, as a judge, I want to stay out of it, and I don't want to express a view on...
So, Judge, I appreciate what you've said about respecting our founding fathers, about the originalism. It's remarkable that we're at a place right now that this is becoming a question and a topic, but I'm asking you, in light of our founding fathers, in light of our traditions, in light that everyone who serves in that office has sworn an oath where they, quote, swear to preserve and protect and defend the Constitution of the United States, I'm just asking you, should a president commit themselves, like our founding fathers, I think, have a clear intention, like the grace that George Washington showed, to the peaceful transfer of power? Is that something that presidents should be able to do?
Well, one of the beauties of America from the beginning of the Republic is that we have had peaceful transfers of power, and that disappointed voters have accepted the new leaders that come into office. And that's not true in every country. And I think it is part of the genius of our Constitution and the good faith and goodwill of the American people that we haven't had the situations that have arisen in so many other countries where there have been, where those issues have been present.
Thank you, Your Honor.
She said nothing.
Oh, wait, there's two more.
Okay.
She won't say if a president can pardon himself, and she, because of the Ginsburg rule, it's something that could come before the court, and she now won't commit, this is Ellie, to the emoluments clause as a thing. He said, I think Senator Booker has used his time well. So he's got answering all these with
I can't say. Pass.
Oh,
pass.
Wow. Unbelievable. Unbelievable.
This is just amazing. And wowsies.
Here's a quote from her.
I really can't speak to what the president has said on Twitter.
Yeah, I saw that one, yes.
Why, because it's not public?
This is from Ellie. Mike Lee wants Amy Coney Barrett to say that expanding the court will affect the separation of powers, but she won't say that because the argument is apparently too dumb for even her to nod along to. Here's another one.
Okay.
This is a LOL GOP. Just one of his takes.
Uh-huh.
Cause of death. Trying to confirm a pro-life justice who wants to take health insurance away from 20 million Americans.
Yeah, that works. Hey, before we run out of time, we'd be remiss if we didn't mention. Okay, do it real quick, and then I'll.
Oh, okay. This is Joe Lockhart. First, Laura Bassett says, "Did he just call her a legal titan who drives a minivan?"
Yeah.
And Joe Lockhart said, "Republicans diminish women at every turn. That's why there is a gender gap."
Uh huh. That's what they do. All right. So last night, Donald Trump started his rallies again, and I guess he's doing one every night. By the way, an old friend of mine posted a thing on Facebook for something in New Jersey. Like he thinks that he's having the biggest rally on the face of the earth tomorrow in New Jersey. And so you could sign up for tickets. So everyone was ordering 10 tickets here and 10 tickets there. And so that was happening. But he's doing these like there was never any problem that there's no, you know, he was throwing masks out into the crowd. Not that anyone was wearing them. They were pocketing them. But anyway, so he goes, he made a proclamation. This was in Sanford, Florida. Remember, that's where Trayvon Martin was killed.
Yes.
First of all, not too far from Orlando at this stadium, this outside stadium. And he actually said this.
Get out. One thing with me, the nice part. I went through it. Now they say I'm immune. I can feel, I feel so powerful. I'll walk into that audience. I'll walk in there. I'll kiss everyone in that audience.
Grab them by the pussy, too.
I'll kiss the guys and the beautiful women and the
beautiful women.
The guys and the beautiful women. If you're not a beautiful woman, if you're just
people
like an average woman, he's not interested. He'll kiss the guys. and the beautiful women.
Well, remember when he sexually assaulted somebody who was sitting across from him on...
Yes, on a plane. He's like, plane. I wouldn't go for
and
that.
He said, why would I do her? You know, why would I want to attack her? Because she's not pretty enough to be raped.
Right, by me. And then he started in with this shit.
I told the story. I told my wife, we're going to have a great time. We're going to watch television. I just got nominated for the Nobel Prize.
It's not a thing.
Oh, God.
Okay.
Oh, my God.
Being nominated for the Nobel Prize is not a thing. It's not a story worth covering. It's not a story worth reporting. No. Thousands of people are nominated for the Nobel Prize each year. It's not a thing.
Yeah,
yet
right.
He goes off. We were watching the news. Now listen to what they complained about. What story were they covering in Florida?
Then I turned on the fake news. Story after story.
A hurricane. Yeah.
They talk about your weather in the panhandle.
A hurricane.
Weather.
This, they talk.
A hurricane.
Story after story, no mention. Remember when Obama got it right at the beginning?
No,
and he didn't
Obama
even know he got it.
Won
the
it.
Biggest story you've ever seen.
Obama was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize. Whether he was deserving of it or not is not the issue. They
right.
covered it when he won, not
right.
when he was nominated. And then he says this.
In fact, a point that they didn't report, I've been, I guess, three or four maybe now, Nobel Peace Prizes. Can you believe it? Four, three.
No.
He won three or four of them. Can you believe it? And they didn't report on any of them.
No.
I'll play it again.
I can't comment on that. It's not a
point that they didn't report.
I've
been, I guess, three or four maybe now.
Nobel Peace Prizes.
Can you believe it? Four, three.
Can you believe it? No. I can't believe it because Donald Trump, you lie every time you open your mouth. You are a liar. Oh, my God. I heard that and my just... lost my
daddy,
shit.
Daddy almost won a prize. Daddy.
three
I'm so
or four
proud
of them
you.
He won. He won.
I'm so proud of you for lying about it three or four times. That's more than you usually win.
Yeah.
That you lied about it so many times is more than usual. I'm so proud of you.
Lindsay, what do you have to say about that?
Trump is a fucking idiot.
Yeah.
Yes, indeed he is.
All right.
Not just an idiot, a fucking idiot.
Right. I did save a couple of tweets as well, if I can find where I put them. There were a few that just, this is lovely. So Jill Filipovich writes, here's a racial discrimination case that Barrett did decide, where she wrote that being called the N-word at work by your supervisor does not constitute a hostile or abusive work environment. He says, the N-word is an egregious racial epithet, she wrote, in Smith versus Illinois Department of Transportation. That said, Smith can't win simply by proving the word was uttered. He must also demonstrate that Colbert's use of this word altered the conditions of his employment and created a hostile or abusive working environment. Barrett went on to say that Smith, quote, introduced no evidence that Colbert's use of the N-word changed his subjective experience of the workplace. To be sure, Smith testified that his time at the department caused him psychological distress, but that was for reasons that predated his run-in with Colbert and had nothing to do with his race. His tenure at the department was rocky from the outset because of his poor track record. Seriously?
We're so fucked.
Oh, and this one, the Politics Video Channel tweeted, breaking, the Cook Political Report just shifted the Texas Senate race toward Democrats.
Yes, I saw that, in fact.
That's
I did see that.
Big. That's really, really big.
I don't know if we can pull it off, but we're sure heading in that direction. If we do that, that would be helpful.
Right. Now one other thing that I need to pass. So Zephyr Teachout, who ran to be the New York Attorney General, unfortunately, she didn't win. She's great. Letitia James did, and she's proving to be great, too. But I've been a fan of Zephyr Teachout's for so long.
She's
awesome.
Yeah.
And so she tweeted, you mentioned Dianne Feinstein a little while ago. She tweeted, why did Schumer not make her step aside and give Klobuchar or someone fierce the lead? There is nothing in Feinstein's history that suggests she's the warrior you want when everything is at stake. And I thought, you know, I need to talk with Zephyr Teach Zephyr. Out again, because it's been too long. So I messaged her on Twitter, and basically, it looks like she's coming on Friday.
Good. Oh, good. Yeah. So I really want to hear what she says.
Yeah,
about
me
that.
Too. And by then, we'll see what happens on Thursday when you know either she'll be voted out of committee or not. So, yeah. So we'll talk to Zephyr Teach out on Friday. Don't know what we're going to do tomorrow, but there's more of this stuff. So we'll get through it.
I need to drink through it.
Yeah, no shit.
I can't take it anymore.
All right, let's go hoist one now. We're out of time. Gotta Laugh. Find her on the Twitters at Gotta Laugh and here on Tuesdays. So see you tomorrow. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.
Friday.
Good. Oh, good.
Yeah.
So I really want to hear what she says.
Yeah,
about
me
that.
Too. And by then, we'll see what happens on Thursday when you know either she'll be voted out of committee or not.